Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate some of the techniques I used to create this demonstration video. You can see I've got an object emitting something that looks a bit like flame, and then it collides with an object here, which is one of the interesting elements, and flows around it. And then I've got some different views of the same scene, and we can see the smoke coming towards the camera, smoke or volumetrics coming towards the camera. And then we've got quite an interesting view of it having flowed around that object and sort of recombining and making some quite interesting effects. So to begin with, we need to just create our smoke simulation. So we'll first of all just add a mesh object, and I'm just going to add a simple cube. I'm going to shrink it down, I'm going to go into orthographic view, and then we'll just scale it on the y-axis just to make it a little bigger in that direction. And we'll put it over here somewhere. I'm then going to go to Objects up here, Quick Effects, and say Quick Smoke. So that will take care of quite a lot of the initial settings for us. If I just press play now, you can see we're getting some basic smoke appearing. But you can see it's just flowing upward, and in mine I had it actually flowing horizontally. You don't have to do that, but it was just an effect I wanted to do, and it also allows me to demonstrate certain other things. So let's go back to the beginning of the animation and select this shape outside, which is the domain object. I'll go to face select and I'll just shrink that down on the Z. We actually don't need it to be very thick at all. And we'll center it down here as well. And I'll take it out to somewhere about here. Maybe we'll expand that slightly, something like that. We'll see how that goes. I'm going to come out of edit mode and then add another object, which is going to be a cylinder. Scale it down, scale it on the Z. We'll look from above. We'll make sure it's lined up with our emitter. Make it a little bigger than that, I think. And we'll put it somewhere about there. It doesn't need to extend outside the domain, so we'll scale on the Z to something like that. So that's our cylinder object, and if we press play, there's our smoke just flowing straight upward. So to begin with, let's stop the smoke just going up. We want it to go horizontally. So with the domain selected, you can see this is currently a domain object here. This is the physics settings, and specifically the smoke settings. We'll click adaptive domain to begin with, because that will help speed the simulation of the smoke up. You can see it's only really simulating in this area at the moment, because that's where the smoke is. So we'll leave the density where it is, but we'll set the temperature difference to zero, because obviously the temperature difference is what causes the smoke to rise. You can see it's just created a bunch of smoke, but it's just sat there around the object now. Although I used a much higher resolution, I'm just going to go up to 64 for the moment, just to give us a little bit more detail so we can see what we're doing. And we'll see, and we'll leave border collisions as open. So that just basically means if the smoke hits the edge of the domain, it will just pass through it as though it's not there, but obviously no longer be visible. And we'll click high resolution here, which sort of simulates a higher resolution of smoke. But again, it's not doing anything at the moment, it's just sitting there. So the next thing I'm going to do is add a force field, which is the wind force field. And you can see it's pointing up to start with. So we'll rotate on the y-axis 90, and I'll move it over to here. I don't think it matters that much where it really is. We'll start with it like that. So if I now just press play, we're actually getting some horizontal movement out of our smoke now. Actually quite a long way there. If I look from above now, you can see what's going on there. So that's not bad. You can see the default settings over here. And I kept all of those as default. There was no need to change any of them. But although our smoke is now flowing off to the right, it's obviously ignoring the existence of this cylinder. So we now need to make the cylinder a collision object. for smoke. So it isn't the collision here, that's for particles and things like that. What we actually want is to click smoke, but then indicate that this is a smoke collision object. We go back to the beginning of the simulation now and press play. We'll take a moment to reach the object. But we should be able to see now there's like a force field around that object. Now, one thing to bear in mind is there are only a limited number of settings for smoke collision, so you will tend to get this effect here, and it's affected also by the size of your simulation and the resolution of your smoke simulation. So if you need that to be a lot closer, let's just select everything and scale 3 times. So I just pressed S3. So if I now press play, off our simulation goes. And it looks a little denser because it's a larger model. But we've still got an issue, obviously, with the resolution of this simulation. So we'll turn that up at this point. That little dot there is our domain name. So we'll go to 128. And now, rather than simply playing the simulation to see how it's working, what we can do, once we've saved, we do need to save, we can go to the cache down here and say bake. One thing about the cache, I'm using the default 250 frame animation here. Make sure the end, and the start for that matter, align with the animation you're trying to create. So if you've got a 1000 frame animation, you'll need to change this to 1000 frames here. So having baked the simulation, we can just play it and see how that looks. And you can see it's playing a lot quicker. So that's improved. And I'm not too worried about it being right up against that cylinder. So now what we need to do is have a look at how that renders. Now I'm specifically doing this for Eevee, but a lot of this will apply to cycles as well. So first of all, I'm going to change to the Eevee render engine. We'll open up another window. We could do this a different way, of course, by using these options up here. And we'll change to the shader editor. So we've got a default material option on here, which is the volume option. I preferred to do it much more simply. So I've removed the principled volumetric shader, and I'm going to add a shader which is an emission shader. Remember to connect this to the volume for the domain here, not to the surface. If you connect it to the surface, this won't work. So if I go to Eevee render view at the moment, you can see it's just a white block. And I'll just at this point change the background to black just to make things easier to see. So we need to add a few more settings here. So I'm going to add an input, which is an attribute. I'm going to type in here the word density. Get no choice on this. That's exactly what you have to put in there with a lowercase, and that reads in the density information that's been created by the smoke simulation. So initially, I'm just going to connect that straight into the strength of my emission shader. And you can see we've got an initial representation of our smoke. And we can press play on there and you can see it moves around. So that's a good start, but obviously it's not very subtle. It doesn't look that great. So the next thing I'm going to do is add the usual color ramp, drop that in there. I used an ease method of transitioning, and then I took this end right the way down here. And you can see what that's doing is it's sort of making it a denser smoke. Perhaps just a little bit more, so about there. And then what I did is add another converter, which is a math converter, drop that in there, change that to multiply, and I left that on a value of 0.5. Although the sharpness of the density fall off has been increased by this color ramp, the maximum density has actually been reduced by this multiply node. So you can see if I turn this down to 0, there is no smoke. If I put it up to 0.1, it's very foggy sort of smoke. I left mine on 0.5, so we'll try that. I then added another color ramp, so I'll just duplicate that one with the same input from that attribute. And I had about 4 points within that color ramp. The leftmost point I just set to a very bright red. Then the next one I set to a nice bright yellow. The next one, a greenish color. A yellowy green, and the top one I left at white, and I left it on ease. I then use that color output as the color of my emission shader. And you can see that gave us quite an interesting fire look to it. It could be smoke, it could be fire. You can use something called a black body source if you want more realistic smoke, but sometimes you just want to control exactly how that looks. And you can obviously play around with where these colors appear to determine the overall look of that smoke. And you can try different blend modes as well. B-spline's a very soft one. Cardinal's very hard. I found that ease was about a good compromise. We now play that. We can see we're starting to get what I had in the video. Now, if you want this collision object to be moving, which I didn't do in my video, but if it is a moving object, under here, you'll need to change that to animated. And then Blender will take account of any movement that you put on that sphere. But before we go any further, what we also need to do is have a little bit of a play with the settings for Eevee. So we're in Eevee mode, which means some of the settings are different to cycles. We'll come to this little computery symbol and we'll turn on bloom. And you can see that goes a little mad. We've got a rather too much bloom there, but it's quite interesting. It sort of enhances the look a little bit. And if we click here, we can see a few more options. I turn that down to somewhere around there, 2, 3, something like that. And everything else I left at default. So we've got a bit of bloom appearing here. It sort of blurs things out a little bit. If I turn it off, you can see the difference, but it also brightens certain areas up. If I click here, by the way, that'll turn off all of the highlighting of any selected objects. So then we can come down to the volumetric settings. So there's a lot that you can do with these. You do need to make sure that your clipping start and end points are appropriate. So in other words, if it clips too soon, the volumetrics will disappear as your camera approaches the volumetrics. And if it clips too soon on the end, the volumetrics will disappear before perhaps they've even finished being rendered in the scene. So in other words, if we look through the camera at this point, if I push the start point out, you can see my volumetrics is disappearing there. And if I pull in the end point, there you go, you can see we're starting to lose the volumetrics there. So you need to make sure that that's reasonable for your camera view. The next thing is about tile sizes. So you can see that's pretty reasonable, but if I turn this down to 2 for the tile size, that actually creates planes of volumetrics that are closer together. So I'm going to just place my camera somewhere usable. Just need to turn the visibility of my camera on there. Just going to do Alt-R just to remove any rotation. Put my camera about here and then just raise it up a little bit and then look through the camera by pressing 0 and we'll back it up a little bit. So I can now look through my camera, and with this set to 8, if I move this around a little bit, you may just be able to see the number of layers of volumetrics there are. But if I set this to 2, it'll actually be slightly slower because there are more layers, but they are finer. So what we'll do here is we'll go to 16, which is obviously the lowest, and we'll render that at just the default settings. So there's a render with 16 pixels for volumetric tile size. We'll go to slot 2, we'll change that to 2, and we'll render again. And you notice how fast it is because, of course, it's EV. And you can see that immediately that's much better, but if I swap to 1 again, you can see it's much more blurry compared to this one. Now there is a setting here that will affect that, and here. However, you can cause it to crash if you go too high on that setting. So you're probably better off leaving that where it is, but you can try higher samples to a point. Again, this will cause it to crash if you go too far. So let's give that a go. So I was able to render that at 100 samples, but when I went to 128, it just wouldn't quite render it. And I've had it just close down Blender before now. So you can see that's pretty fair. And it was only 3.75 seconds to render it. And that was a smoke simulation that was not a particularly high one. So let's have a look at what happens if I modify that smoke simulation to be much higher resolution. So first of all, I need to delete the bake. So there's the resolution I've currently got set. And I used a resolution of 256, which will take a little while to simulate. So I'll do that. I'll stop the recording and then we'll see what that's like once it's done. So the simulation is complete, and let's see what that looks like. You can see there's a lot more detail to the smoke now. And you can see it's getting closer to the cylinder. So if we go to a rendered view, see that's quite interesting. Again, that was rendered at 100 samples and 2 pixels per tile. Essentially, the way volumetric rendering works in Eevee is it creates slices through it, and then you're effectively looking through those slices. And the smaller this number, the more slices there are. And then in terms of the slices themselves, I think the samples here affects the quality of each slice. So you want the highest number you can manage with the video RAM you have available. So that depends on the size of your video card and the maximum number of slices that you feel you need to use. Generally, you'll go higher with that. But obviously, that also affects the amount of video RAM that's going to be used. So that was a quick tutorial. Hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know. And I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.